the rise of China as much to do with, it starts with maybe reverse engineering. Maybe you can reverse engineer the knife. You can see that, how is that knife made? Why is that cutting that coconut? Why is our knife not cutting the coconut? And then it, actually you do this 5 years, 7 years, you'll figure out more and more in this. You'll figure out the metallurgy of it. You'll figure out a lot more about materials. And this is essentially the story of Zoho. The last 22 years, we have gone through maybe 3 or 4 generations of this R&D evolution. From maybe what you'd see a 5% team to 50% team R&D. Now we can do 500% team R&D, which massively complicated moving parts. That 500% R&D team would rival the MRI machine type of thing. That's where you are building really, really sophisticated products. Our Zoho office suite would be that kind of 500% R&D, where you have lots of moving parts. You have lots of different things that have to work together. So that we could not have built it 20 years ago. It's again, I want to emphasize, not because the particular individuals doing it at that time are stupid. It is because you have to build a cultural and institutional know-how. The cultural capital. Before you can get financial capital, you have to build the cultural capital and the institutional capital. And a lot of times, in my own opinion, we put the financial capital first. The return won't come if the R&D capital isn't there. The cultural capital isn't built. And we have not built it. And there's a couple of reasons. Actually, my brother, who is also an entrepreneur, he joked with me, you look at all those countries, Japan and Korea and now China, you know, they all their engineers work in their own language, except us. And there's actually a point. The way it hurt is not because English language is bad, that's not the reason. The way it hurt us is, before we build up that cultural capital, we end up globalizing ourselves.